Hey there, how are you?
Not only because they don't need it, but also because our intrepid journalist, Max Blau, will be able to do that job for me. I do want to mention just a couple of quick notes, and then one thing I was thinking about as I walked through the room, because as you can see, I have not prepared notes, and so you have to listen to me until I have done. Two important things. If you do have your cell phones on, please silence them, or at the very least, please put them on airplane mode or vibrate. We would all appreciate it. It's better for the mics, and it's better for everyone to be able to hear. Secondly, if for some reason you do need to get up in the middle of the interview or the panel, please just try to do so as quickly as you can, or even at a break within the program, just so that those behind you are able to see and hear without interruption. We're going to start with a 30 to 35 minute conversation between Max and Stephen about not just Stephen's career, but also the Foster v. Chatman case in particular. We'll follow that with a panel with the entire team from the Southern Center, who you can get to meet shortly, who will be talking about this case. One thing I thought about as I was walking in here, when I was driving into work this morning, my good friend Dennis O'Hare at WADE informed me over the radio that today is the 20th anniversary of the opening ceremony of the 1996 Centennial Olympic Games. That made me think, why do we have the Olympics to begin with? What is it that causes us to bring our attention and our passion and our energy and our time to focus on these feats of daring do, this contest of, well, as they say, Kittius, Altius, Fortius, right? Faster, higher, stronger. It's because we're amazed by the feats of human experience, of what we can do when we really train hard and care a lot and put our everything into something. Well, I can think of no better example of an Olympic-level, pantheon, extraordinary legal athlete in the history of the United States than Stephen B. Wright. And we are very lucky to be able to hear from him today. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Max Blau, Stephen write, and possibly Chatman a case study of justice. Max, I'll leave it to you.
How's everyone doing?
Fine, thanks.
Can you hear me all right?
Yeah.
Thank you for having me here, and thank you for the interview. And I think maybe the best place to start is at the beginning, and wondering if you could, for those who don't know your story, share how you first got into death penalty in the capital cases and into doing the kind of work that you've been doing for over 3 decades.
Well, as I often say, I was minding my own business, practicing law in Washington, D.C., and a volunteer from the ACLU called me, Patsy Morris, many of you knew Patsy when she was in life, and asked me if I would take a death case of a young man who was under death sentence in Georgia, just been sentenced to death, and wanted someone to file a petition for writ certiorari to the Supreme Court of the United States. And I said to her, well, I don't know why you call me. I'm a trial lawyer. I'm not really an appellate lawyer. I don't do any Supreme Court practice. I'm in Washington. We don't have the death penalty here. Quite frankly, we hadn't even thought a great deal about the death penalty at that time because I was only 3 years old at that time. She said, don't worry, we'll take anybody we can get. And based on that flattering request, I said, okay. It seemed terrible to me that somebody could be facing the death penalty and not have a lawyer. But of course, she explained to me, and I learned other things, that you have a right to a lawyer trial, Gideon versus Wainwright, you have a right to a lawyer for one appeal, Douglas versus California. And the Supreme Court, in its wisdom, has said no right to a lawyer after that to petition for certiorari, even in a death penalty case, to file for state post-conviction review, even in a death penalty case. Now, statutorily, there's a right to counsel in federal habeas, but that was not the case back then. And I was absolutely flabbergasted that that could be the case, that we could have the death penalty if people not have lawyers. And then she shipped me up the record, and I sort of had prepared, you know, for this Ryder truck to pull up and all this huge record. Actually, it was about this thick. The whole thing just came in a FedEx package, and I could read it all one evening very quickly. And I said, you know, students try shoplifting cases in the clinic here in D.C. a lot better than this death case was tried. It's really shocking. And then the last part, I then came down and met Donnie Thomas, my client, and he was profoundly mentally ill, schizophrenic, out of touch with reality, couldn't tell me anything about the trial. None of this was in the record, the jury that sentenced him to death. In fact, the whole penalty phase was just two really bad closing arguments, one by the prosecutor and one by the defense lawyer. So I was pretty shocked by that, and not long afterwards, Patsy asked me to take another case in William Brooks in Columbus, where we could tell the race of every juror by just reading the cold record by the way that the judge and the prosecutor treated them. All the black people would be kind of led into being disqualified, and all the white people would be kind of led into not being disqualified. And finally, in 1982, it sort of made sense, since I had a number of cases, but then to come down, and so I did, and been there since.
When we spoke for the story that I wrote for Atlanta Magazine, you described to me that in this period, or at least the first case you did, there was a reluctance that you had to take on, to do the work initially, and then you were, and then ultimately you did it because no one else would. I think it's easy to, given where your career has gone since then, to see that as an easy feat. But I'm wondering if you can kind of walk through the process or kind of takes back to your mindset when you're first doing these cases, having never worked on a capital case before. Was that overwhelming? What was that? Was that something? It had to be a new experience, of course. How difficult was it to go through this? You know, having practiced law but never done capital cases, kind of being thrown into that. What was that like for you?
Well, it was challenging, but I would say when I saw the quality of representation that people were getting, I realized, I mean, of course, you can't justify how bad you are by saying other people are worse and everything, but it was clear to me that there was a tremendous need for people that had some ability to think strategically, to understand Supreme Court cases, maybe to read Supreme Court cases, and so forth. And I felt pretty confident I could do those things, and so I felt pretty good about getting involved in it. I mean, there's no question, it's very challenging to have a human being's life in your hands, and the first client of mine who was executed in 1985, Joseph Charles Shaw, to be with somebody to work so hard on their behalf and ultimately watch them as the state put them to death and serve as a pallbearer at their funeral, I mean, that's sobering. And something you don't encounter in other kinds of law practice, needless to say. But the need is there, and so that matched up with my goals pretty much.
Was there a certain point where you realized you would be doing this kind of law for the rest of your life? And if so, what was that moment?
Well, I think when I got down to Georgia, and you know, I've often said, you know, we got here and we didn't have any money. I wrote a personal check out to pay the rent in our office in the Healy building when I first got down. And not too long after that, the Open Door community donated a car to us. You know you're on the lower end of the philanthropic food chain when you're getting donations from the homeless shelter. you're really, that's about as low as it goes. And so it was quite a struggle, and my sense of it was that things were not going to get any better. Things have gotten better, but certainly I came down in 82, and certainly in the 80s and 90s, this was a very, very, very tough time. A lot of people were being executed, a lot of people were being sentenced to death, and it certainly looked to me like there was a long road ahead.
I'm wondering if you can talk about Timothy Tyrone Foster. He was, within the first 5 years that you were down here, his trial was going on. He was originally convicted in 1907. And I'm wondering if you eventually went on to work with him almost 2 decades later. What, tell us about him, having met him before, having worked with him, who he was at that point in time, you know, when he was convicted of the crime.
Well, at the time of the trial, Timothy Foster was 18 years old, was intellectually disabled man. The case was tried in 1987, which was the year after the Supreme Court of the United States decided Batson versus Kentucky. And of course, that was the case when the court finally acknowledged what had always been the practice, once black people actually got in jury pools, which didn't happen for a long time, after the Civil War, and certainly in Georgia didn't, but then of course once that happened, then the prosecutors would strike all the people of color, so you had all white juries. I mean, William Brooks was tried in Columbus, Georgia, which was probably about 30% African American at the time of his trial. He was tried by an all white jury, partly because of the way the judge and the prosecutors manipulated the jurors to get rid of the black jurors, but also because whatever African Americans were left, the prosecution struck. This is just what happened. And when this case came down, the two court-appointed lawyers in Rome who were representing Tim Foster filed a motion. A lot of lawyers didn't do this, and a lot of lawyers were quite intimidated about raising race as an issue. But they filed a motion. They said, in this county, Floyd County, in this circuit, the prosecution always strikes all the blacks whenever they pick a jury. And in this case, they are going to strike all the blacks like they do in every other case. But last year, the Supreme Court decided this case called Batson versus Kentucky. So Judge, we're asking you, don't let them strike all the blacks in this case.
And for those not familiar with Batson versus Kentucky, what was decided in that case?
Yeah, well, when Batson finally, you know, there's a lot of criticism. There's a case called Swain versus Alabama, 1965 case, right in the Warren Court Code Revolution. Miranda and all those cases are coming down. Robert Swain was tried in Talladega, Alabama, and there had never been, at the time of his trial, an African American who had sat as a juror in Talladega County, which was 25% African American. And you raised the fact that the prosecutor struck all the blacks, and the Supreme Court, in opinion by Justice White, said peremptory strikes are just part of our tradition, part of our juries in cases in the United States, and you can strike people for any reason, religion, race, whatever, what Thurgood Marshall later called just an open invitation to race discrimination. Of course, it didn't need to be an invitation issue because everybody's discriminating already, just like it happened in Swain's case. In Batson, the Supreme Court theoretically was going to do something about it. What they really did was do what the court is so good at doing, which is cover it up with some procedural mumbo-jumbo so that the discrimination could continue. Basically, the court said that if there is a disparate number of people of color struck, then the other side, let's say the defense in this case, could challenge that, and the prosecutor had to give a reason. And then the judge would uphold the reason, and the juror would be struck. So you'd still have discrimination, but you'd go through this little procedural charade, is what one appellate court called it, in which theoretically this was not race discrimination. This juror wasn't struck because of race. They were struck because they looked at the ceiling during jury. Well, they looked at the floor.
What's the most egregious example of that you've heard in your career?
Oh, that'd be hard to say. One of the first cases that we had after that was Gamble, Willie Gamble's case out of Swainsboro, which had struck 10 out of 10. Among the reasons was one person was struck because, one juror was struck because he looked like the defendant. They were both black men. It looked somewhat like the pigmentation. Another juror was struck because he was a Mason, and the prosecutor didn't like people who were members of Masonic lodges. This fellow happened to be a brick mason, so it didn't really apply. That was when he was struck. Another juror was struck because, as the prosecutor put it, he looked dumb as a fence post. The Georgia Supreme Court reversed that in Gamble's case when it came before the Georgia Supreme Court on appeal. So those are some of the worst reasons. Prosecutors now have sessions where they distribute reasons. Of course, the reasons are supposed to be the actual reason for striking the juror. But that's usually race, and can't admit that, right? So they give out race-neutral reasons, so you just take your list of race-neutral reasons, and when the other side objects, you just look down at your list, and you say, fail to maintain eye contact. That's a race-neutral reason. In fact, in this case, one of the reasons was verbatim out of a case. So they not only gave that as a reason, but then later in their brief, they cited that case to say it was a race-neutral reason, because it was kind of a prepackaged race-neutral reason. If Batson doesn't mean anything more than that, it doesn't mean anything at all.
To the contrary, are there, when jurors, when prosecutors use their strikes to rule out jurors, are there ever examples where that's necessary?
Oh, sure. I mean, you know, all people, white, black, men, women, I mean, people can be biased in some way, and there can be legitimate reasons. Of course, as most of you know, but for anybody that doesn't, there are two kinds of strikes. One strikes for cause, if there's somebody that knows one of the parties or for whatever reason can't be fair and impartial, that person will be struck by the judge. And the parties don't, other than asking for it, and maybe being for it or against it, don't have any, don't decide that. But then in Georgia, at the end of that process, each side has a certain number of strikes that you can strike anyone, used to be for any reason whatsoever, now any reason except race or gender. But all that means is that if you do strike, let's say 10 out of 10 African Americans, the other side hopefully will object, and then the lawyer will give the so-called race-neutral reasons, and the judge will think about it for a minute. Of course, the judge probably was the prosecutor who struck all the blacks himself when he was a district attorney before he became judge. So, and this is probably his former chief assistant in front of him. So he knows what the deal is, and he's going to, of course, say it's a race-neutral reason. The other thing, just think about it psychologically. You're asking the judge to make a finding that the prosecutor intentionally discriminated on the basis of race, and second, lied about it by giving a false reason. The real reason was race, but they lied and gave a false reason. I mean, how many judges, elected judges, who work with that prosecutor day in and day out, is going to make that make those two findings? Probably they're going to be in a tough re-election campaign if they do. So as a practical matter, Batson is not really going to prevent race discrimination, even when it's pretty blatant.
In the case of Foster, how specifically does that ruling affect what happened here later? What would the juror pool look like? Can you maybe give us a sense of how the process went with your client?
Sure. Well, there are a number of people, 120 people or so, were all summoned. We've all gotten a summons in the mail and say you're going to have jury duty. We all love that. Of course, a lot of people don't show up. But of the people that do come, the judge excuses a lot of people for hardship, for whatever reason they can't serve as jurors. And then they go through the strikes for cause as a reason that people can't serve. And then they boil that down to where you have enough people that after each side exercise its strikes, you have 12 people, usually 12 people and two alternates left to be the jury. And that's what happened in this case. At the end of that process, there were five African Americans in the jury pool of the people that would be struck down to 12. And each side would have peremptory strikes, 10 peremptory strikes. Well, actually, in those days, the defense had more than that. But the prosecutor would have 10 strikes to use to whittle the number down.
And ultimately, what happened in terms of the jury that was selected?
Well, as always happened, and as the lawyers, and in fact, it's interesting because before trial, they were talking about the Batson motion, and in the discussion between the prosecutor and the defense lawyers and the judge, there was never any suggestion that there would not be a Batson hearing. In other words, there was no suggestion that there wouldn't be discrimination or they wouldn't strike all the blacks. It was just a matter of the logistics of when will we have it. And we'll keep the people at the courthouse so that, you know, if the judge, surprise, surprise, should rule that one strike was racially motivated, we could put that person back on the jury. There was some discussion of logistics, and it was just taken for granted there'd be a Batson hearing. So, of course, the prosecutor did, as expected, as predicted in this motion, struck four out of four. One juror had to be struck for cause that morning because she knew somebody. And so the result was the defense objected. These lawyers weren't afraid to object. Even though the prosecutor stood there and said at one point, we demand that these defense lawyers apologize to us and apologize to this community for accusing us of race discrimination. Given what we found out later, that required a certain amount of audacity. At any rate, the prosecutors gave nine to 12 reasons for each juror. Is one anything they can think of as a reason for striking the jury. And the judge, of course, upheld them, and the Georgia Supreme Court upheld them on appeal. And
then you get the case in 2006.
Right. And just real quick, to cut to the chase, this is what has happened in these Batson cases that have come out. Well, there's some serendipitous fact happens. We made an Open Records Act request to see the prosecution's file. The prosecutor who prosecuted this case, Steve Lanier, had some questionable financial transactions while he was district attorney with the public funds, and he had left office because of that, and another prosecutor had come in, and she'd become a judge, and now we were a third prosecutor, who, of course, so were two prosecutors removed from the trial. And nobody bothered to go through the prosecutor's files and maybe remove some things that might be, you know, embarrassing. So when we looked at it, there were the notes from the prosecutor's jury strikes.
How rare is that in your career? How, in terms of finding something like that in a case, how often do you come across evidence to that is that place?
Not too often, but it's not unheard of. I mean, Joe Riley, in a case that we had, we later found after the trial that Joe had sent a memorandum to the jury commissioners telling him to underrepresent blacks in the jury pools. Obviously, this was never supposed to see the light of day, but by some serendipitous fact, it did. And resulted in Amadeo versus Kemp, a case in the Supreme, earlier case we had in the Supreme Court. So those things are out there. It's just a question of whether you find them or not. But in this case, the prosecutor had taken all of the lists of all the jurors who were going to be called and highlighted all the blacks in green and had a little key at the top of each page. Green means black. And there are several copies of these, and each one had been color-coded. And then just in case anyone was colorblind, they'd also put a little B beside each black person's name. And basically circulated around the prosecutor's office to, if you've got anything on any of these people, let us know. Tell us what you're doing. You're looking for reasons for striking these people. And then on the jury questionnaires, the race of the jurors was circled. Maybe that's not that surprising. But then there's a list of the black jurors, and they're listed B1, B2, and B3. They didn't list the white jurors with W1, W2. And then there were some memos in which they had compared the African-American prospective jurors against each other that had things in them like, well, if it comes down to having to accept a black, Ms. Garrett might be okay. Whereas the prosecutor had written in there, of all the blacks, Ms. Garrett has the most potential to be a juror. But as it turned out, if you turn the next page over, you saw that Ms. Garrett was never in the running for being on the jury because the prosecutor had a list of definite no's, people who definitely were going to be struck. And they were the five African Americans. They were the top five. They were the priority strikes, followed by one white woman who had indicated in answers that she was opposed to the death penalty. And that's all, there were just six. And as I said, one of the blacks was that morning excused for other reasons. So those people were definitely gonna be struck. One of the people, Eddie Hood, was struck, he was B1, Eddie Hood, because he was a member of the Church of Christ. That was one of the 12 reasons for striking him. And the prosecutor represented to the court that the Church of Christ was adamantly opposed to the death penalty. Well, right there in the prosecutor file is a sheet out of legal pad. Church of Christ, right below it, takes no position on the death penalty. Leaves it up to each member. And then down below that, no, underlined twice, black church underlined several times. So it's pretty clear that there was a certain race consciousness that had gone into planning for these strikes. And that in fact the blacks have been taken out of the pool, compared against one another, but basically been put in a set of definite no's that were going to be struck. There were other, I won't go into them, but the Eddie Hood, the Church of Christ thing was maybe the most dramatic example of the prosecutor just lying to the court. But there were other examples as well, because there were things in the file that just completely contradicted what the prosecutor told the judge as his reasons for striking the jurors.
And for a broader context, how common or uncommon was rogue Georgia, Floyd County at this point in time, around the time this trial was happening, compared to other states in the South or across the nation?
In terms of striking blacks?
Yes.
It was just like everybody else. I mean, as the lawyers put in their motion, there are other capital trials, there are other kinds of trials, all kinds of trials, but the prosecution's office did strike all people of color. This case was tried by Lanier, who was the prosecutor up there, as I said, who left under quite a cloud, but who struck blacks when he picked juries. He was assisted for some reason by Doug Pullen from Columbus, who was brought in as, I guess, an expert on either the death penalty or race discrimination or both. Very good at both. So you had two prosecutors who really had, and he too was left under a cloud. He got appointed to the bench, as so many prosecutors do, but then later resigned during a JQ, the Judicial Qualification Commission was investigating some things that he did as a judge. And he was doing things as a prosecutor that probably should have been investigated. The first intellectually disabled person, the only one that we killed, well, the first one was Governor Georgia, Jerome Bowden. Doug Pullen tried that case, struck 10 out of 10, all the blacks, and tried that case in all ways. Sure, he got the death penalty, and Jerome Bowden was put to death. So you had a pretty lethal combination with these two prosecutors, and you also had two prosecutors whose way of getting their way was to exclude people of color from the jury.
In all the people you've seen, clients you've had in your career who have served on death row, served time on death row for any extended period of time, what is the, for someone like Timothy Hiram Foster, in your personal experience, who's been there for nearly 30 years down in Jackson, what is the effect that you've seen on being on death row for that long time?
Well, it's devastating. I think Camus said, just in general, not the death point, there's nobody so horrible that they would put a person in a cage and tell them that on a certain day at a certain hour they'd be put to death. And that's just nobody is that outrageous. Does things that outrageous at the state of Georgia and the other states that have the death penalty. But what has been particularly tough, I think, for Mr. Foster is that, you know, we've killed 12 people in the last 2 years. He sent me a note or letter the other day in which he mentioned that his best friend had just been executed. But through the letter, he mentioned other people that he knew who had been executed. There were 10 in this letter. 10 people that he knew. This is not people who have been executed in the last, you know, since he got to death row. These are people killed in the last 2 years who were being taken away from the cell block where he was and being put to death. A remarkable thing to go through if you think about it. Particularly knowing you're next or you're in line. I don't think Tim ever thought we'd win the case until we did. And so, you know, there's always that thought that your day will come and you too will be taken from the cell and be taken over to the death house and put to death. The death penalty is a fairly barbaric punishment just in itself, but the way we treat people leading up to it is one of the really barbaric aspects of it.
You oppose death penalty, of course, on moral ground. Do you ever see it going away in your lifetime?
And it is going away. I don't think there's any question.
When do you think that'll be?
Well, I don't think there's any question. Almost everybody agrees now. In fact, even the prosecutors I talk to now pretty much agree that we will not have the death penalty. It's almost like 5, 10, 15, whatever years it is. But in the 1990s, when things were really tough in this business, as tough as they ever were, we were executing juries were imposing the death penalty in 290 to 310 cases a year. It varied between those numbers. But so 310 was the most people sentenced to death. And then starting the year 2000, those numbers started coming down, came down to 100, came down below 100, got down to 150, got down to 125, then got below 100. So we had a couple of years, less than 3 years ago, 77. 75, last year 49. So we've gone from 320 people definitely imposed upon to 49 in this huge country that we have. 25 of those cases are out of California, which doesn't execute anybody, just piles them up on death row. So that means out of the rest of the United States, of the other 30 states that have the death penalty, they've sent 25 people to death last year. And 2% of all the counties in the country account for almost all the death sentences that have been first imposed and that have been carried out. So the fact of the matter is we're down to the Deep South where the death penalty continues to, but even here in Georgia, nobody's been sentenced to death in Georgia since March of 2014. So that's been a while. We're killing people who were sentenced to death, like John Wayne Connor was killed the other night, 34 years ago. People sentenced to death in the 70s and 80s, represented by terrible lawyers and prosecuted by people like Doug Pullen and Steve Lanier. But today, we're not seeing hardly any people being sentenced to death, even in Georgia. We still are in Texas, and we still are in this handful of counties, certainly in Jacksonville, Florida, in Alabama, but it's not very many places. So I think it's just a matter of time until we have some states that have one person on death row. New Hampshire has one person on death row and an execution since 1934. You know, if you've done without something since 1934, you can probably do without it from now on. So they'll repeal, as other states, New Jersey and Illinois and other states that repealed the death penalty. A number of states having just gone down. No state that repealed has gone back the other way. So it appears to be a pretty clear trend. And of course, that's consistent with the rest of the world in terms of declining the death penalty. The only other industrialized nation that has the death penalty is Japan, which doesn't carry it out hardly at all.
Politically speaking, you're starting to see in the Deep South conservative groups who are organizing and opposing it on the grounds that it's limiting freedoms of individuals, taking their lives. It's more expensive to execute someone. And I'm wondering, as you looked through the Deep South in states like Georgia, Tennessee, Alabama, those are the holdouts, or the majority of them. What do you think it would take politically to turn the tide and to potentially see the eventual death penalty, the end of it in the United States, happening in the South, in terms of a governor placing a moratorium, somebody in India doing that?
Well, let's not get carried away, but I don't maybe see that. But we do have three governors that have declared moratorium. There's Governor Hickenlooper in Colorado. He only has three people on there. One guy wanted to give up his appeals and get executed, and Hickenlooper said, I don't care if you want him, I'm not going to kill you anyway. I'm not going to have you that phone in Colorado. And so then Governor Washington and Governor of Oregon. So in addition to the states that have abolished the death penalty, you have moratorium ordered by the governor. I think we've already seen what gets us there, which is all the exoneration. We've had so many people exonerated, people who were convicted, many served a long time, ultimately found to be innocent. But 100, and I believe Anthony Hinton, who Brian Stevenson represented over in Alabama, was the 152nd, I believe, innocent person. He spent 30 years on death row for a crime he didn't commit. That sobers a lot of people up, I think, when you realize. And of course, we've had innocent people executed. And I think a lot of people don't want to admit that, but increasingly, if you read Jim Lieberman's book, The Wrong Carlos, about Carlos de Luna, almost certainly innocent, executed in Texas. If you look at the work that's been done around Todd Willingham in Texas, arson case, people make lots of mistakes in arson cases, because you can't tell whether a fire so often was accidentally set or whether it was purposely set. And a lot of the science is very, very, very questionable. Willingham, I think, was innocent. But he was put to death. In fact, there was another fellow who was convicted of an arson almost exactly like Willingham's, a guy named Willis, Ernest Ray Willis. He had the good fortune of having a New York law firm take his case, and they got the best fire scientists and people in the country to look at it and took it to the DA and convinced the district attorney in that case that Willis was innocent, and he was released from death row. If you reverse the lawyers in those two cases, if Willingham had been represented by Willis's lawyers and Willis had been represented by Williams's lawyers, Willingham would be free today and Willis would be dead. That's how this works. And so I think more and more, as those cases come to light, it causes people to have second thoughts. Of course, we also have the alternative life imprisonment with any possibility of parole, which makes a lot of people wonder, why are we spending so much money on the death penalty? As you were saying, some of the more conservative people are saying, why spend this huge amount of money on a government program? If you're conservative, you may have some doubts about how well the government works, whether the government can do anything right, deliver the mail, teach students, whatever. Let me tell you, the government excels in those areas compared to the criminal justice system. The criminal justice system is the part of society least affected by the civil rights movement. It's as racist as it can be, as it always has been. and probably always will be, I'm sorry to say. And so trusting something like life and death to the government is something I think a lot of people are uncomfortable with, particularly when there's another alternative available that will protect the community, that will severely punish the person who committed the crime, and if we do discover 30 years down the road that we've made a mistake, we can't give the person back the 30 years, they're gone. But we can at least give them the rest of their life, which for Michael Morton, who's been 25 years in Texas, 25 years of your life, it's just gone. Take that part of your life from age 30 to whatever, it's just gone. It's just not part of your life anymore, but at least you have what's left of your life, which you don't have that, of course, obviously, if you put somebody down, if you've executed somebody.
We're going to get back to the Foster case, but I wanted to bring everyone else up that was on the panel who was helpful and essential to the building the case, the Foster case, and so I don't know where you all are.
Patrick Mulvaney. We have Katie Chamblee, both lawyers who were on the case, we were counsel table during the oral argument. And we have Kristin Samuels, our ACE investigator, who is on the case and has been spending a lot of time in Rome.
And maybe we'll start with Patrick. If you're on the road, just introduce yourself, say what your position is with the Southern Center, and what give us a brief synopsis of what your involvement with the Foster case. Because obviously everyone is working on this to some degree, but specifically kind of where you came to the case and how you involved
it. Sure. I'm Patrick Mulvaney, and I'm the managing attorney for capital litigation at the Southern Center for Human Rights. I started working on this case when we were in the Butts County Superior Court around 2009, 2010. It was just a year or two after I got to the Southern Center. Steve had been working on the case already for about 3 or 4 years. When I joined the case, we were writing the first brief to the state habeas court that was relying on the prosecutor's notes to litigate this Batson claim, this race discrimination claim. So we were arguing to the Superior Court judge that this was, in fact, race discrimination in the case, that these notes changed the whole picture of what had happened, and that the notes made clear that the strikes were based on race and not based on any of the reasons that the prosecutor said at trial. So I got involved in the case then. We wrote the brief. We lost. We appealed to the Georgia Supreme Court and lost there, and then continued on through to the U.S. Supreme Court. Unfortunately, things changed when we got there.
And the reason we got to the Supreme Court is the cert petition that Patrick prepared. You want to talk about that?
Sure. So
the unique aspect.
So the notes in this case, the prosecutor's notes, as Steve mentioned, they had highlighted the names of the black jurors in green with a key that said green highlighting represents blacks, and they had circled the race of the black jurors and called them B1, B2, and B3, and so on. So in the cert petition, we included images in the actual petition itself, so we would have a paragraph explaining what happened, and then we filed the petition in color so that we could have the green highlighting in the actual petition, and just to try to show the court how outrageous this was, and that the Georgia courts had not found a problem with any of it. And so all of what we thought were the most significant notes that showed that the prosecutors were discriminating on the basis of race and misrepresenting these reasons to the court, we just pasted in the images right into the petition. It was a relatively short petition. We just said, this is race discrimination. They struck all the black jurors. They gave 40 reasons for the four strikes. They actually then argued at the penalty phase of this case. The prosecutor argued, having secured an all-white jury, he argued for that the jury should sentence Tim Foster to death, quote, to deter other people out there in the projects. And 90% of the families living in the North Rome housing projects at the time were black. So this was clearly a racially divisive argument, capitalizing on the strikes, capitalizing on securing an all-white jury. So we just tried to lay out the facts in the cert petition and say, this is what happened in this case, and the Georgia courts didn't have a problem with it, and we think that the Supreme Court should look at it. Unfortunately, they didn't.
This shows the value of demonstrative evidence, because normally the Supreme Court is not going to take just an error correction case, which this was. This is not a split in the circuits. It was not the great issue of the day. It was just some kid in Georgia at 18 years old had been discriminated against, and here you look and see for yourself what it was. And I think that's what got cert granted. It's not a case normally cert would be granted in, and I think Patrick's cert petition is what got us up to the court. And also saved Mr. Foster's life, because this was all the state post-conviction process. If we had not gotten reviewed by the Supreme Court, we would have gone into federal habeas corpus, which would not probably have been successful given the law and the deference that the federal courts give to the state courts in this case.
I'm Katie Chamblee. I'm a staff attorney at the Southern Center for Human Rights. I actually got involved in the Foster case during my very first year at the Southern Center when I was there as a fellow. Patrick asked me to help write the Batson claim on the cert petition to the Georgia Supreme Court. It's a similar process. They decide whether or not to take the case. So I started looking at the evidence, and I remember as I was writing the brief, I was having so much fun, and I came to Patrick and said, we're going to win this case. This is an amazing case. I just could not believe it. And he said, no, we're not. And I was just shocked, and I said, why? And he said, ask Steve why no one ever wins Batson cases. So I did, and he gave a speech very similar to the one you heard earlier this evening. And it turns out it was true. The Georgia Supreme Court decided not to hear the case. And this wasn't a situation where, like the U.S. Supreme Court, they said it's not important enough or we just don't have time. They're supposed to take any case that has arguable merit. And so in not taking this case, they were saying, not only is it a loser, there's not even a reason for us to think about why maybe it should win. And so I think I was the only member of the team that was completely shocked by that decision when we got denied. And like Steve and Patrick, I worked on the briefs in the Supreme Court case. And like Steve, I also think that Patrick's repetition saved Ted Foster's life.
Hi, my name is Kristin Samuels. I am a capital investigator at the Southern Center, and I work with these awesome attorneys here. I became a part of Tim Foster's team around the time that the oral argument was about to take place in DC at the US Supreme Court. Of course, I was really, really excited to hear that Steve, Patrick, and Katie were able to really bring this to the U.S. Supreme Court. And so we thought it would be a perfect time to go back to the 1980s and talk with the jurors who got struck. What happened with them was we didn't know exactly how it affected their lives or what their lives really had been like in Rome up to that point and after that point. And so I went and spoke with Eddie Hood, Marilyn Garrett, who's now married, and she's Marilyn Whitehead, and Mary Turner.
And Kristin, can you maybe use an example, take Eddie Hood or Marilyn, and describe to us how being in a jury and being going through the process of being excluded or struck back in the late 80s still sticks with them today?
Yeah, well, one of the things that struck me with Eddie Hood is that he just an average person who went ahead and moved to Rome, Georgia, after living just about an hour away from Rome most of his life. Within 2 years of moving there, he registered to vote like a responsible citizen would. He got called for jury duty for the Foster case. And the first day that he showed up to court, he went home and he looked at his wife and he was really upset, and he told his wife that none of us are going to be chosen. And when he said us, he meant people who looked like him and his wife, any of the black people in the courtroom. And so for Eddie Hood, it was devastating. Eddie Hood was born in the 1940s, so racism wasn't new to him, but it was still pretty devastating that he wouldn't be a part of this process just because he was black. What's really sad is that he knew it. He knew what the DA was doing, and he knew about the reputation of the prosecutors in Rome at that time.
Ms. Garrett.
Ms. Garrett, she is a little younger than Eddie Hood. She's now 64, but she was poor at the time. She was a single mom. She had two children. She went on the stand and she remembered Steve Lanier asking her, "Well, where do you work? Why do you have two jobs?" And she became humiliated throughout that questioning because she had to explain that she had two jobs because she was poor. She worked at a cotton mill, she worked at a Head Start program, and she needed to do everything to pay the bills for her two children. And so for her, in this room filled with tons of people, she had to explain that she was poor. And she had to live with that that day, and it still affects her now. When the case went to the U.S. Supreme Court, she told me she was really afraid of like all the publicity because she didn't want to have to explain that how she felt, that she felt poor, and she knew, of course, because she was also black and poor. And so it had a real impact on her as well.
This is a question for any of you. We've been talking this whole night about racial discriminations in terms of the jury selection, and in the simplest sense, why is it important to have diverse juries? What does that do to the process of an actual trial? And in particular, if you want to talk about Foster or any other case.
Really two things. The first is the legitimacy of the process. When you have all white juries convicting people, and you see a racially disproportionate result, which is what we see not only in the death penalty, but in all areas of the criminal justice system, it's very disturbing in a place with such a recent history of racial injustice like we have here. And it undermines people's confidence in the courts, and it makes people feel like they're not being treated fairly, and like they don't have dignity in the eyes of the law. And so that first reason is perceptual. What's interesting, though, is that it actually improves the quality of deliberation as well. There was a very comprehensive study done on this in 2006. What they did is they put together several mock juries. A psychologist did this. And they gave them a real case, evidence from a real case, in which the guy had been acquitted. So this was evidence where at least, you know, the jury that actually heard the case decided there was reasonable doubt. And they had, half of the juries were all white, and half of them had four white jurors and two black jurors. They found that the juries with black jurors on them deliberated longer, they were less likely to make factual errors when they came up with their opinions, they were less likely to leave out key facts, they were more likely to correct mistaken assumptions, both things that the prosecutor or defense might have said or things that one another had said. And so it was a pretty definitive answer for those researchers that the quality of deliberation is better. They kind of mused on why that might be. And, you know, I don't know the answer. It could be, you know, one option is that, you know, people of color add something to the jury that people who haven't experienced racism don't. I think that's doubtlessly true. But they also found that the white people on the jury changed their behaviors when people of color were there. And so it not only improved because of their presence, it also improved everyone else on the jury.
In terms of, this is a question for any of you, in terms of putting the petition together and from that moment forward, can you speak a bit about the number of hours that you brought, or the amount of work that goes into putting a document like that together? yet before sending to the Supreme Court. Across from interns doing research all the way up to you reviewing it and going over it. What is that process like for anyone who's not working with Southern Center?
It was a big process. we were very fortunate with the timing of the cert grant in this case. The cert was actually granted on the very first day that our summer law students arrived at the Southern Center last year. So we said, welcome to the office, we're gonna have a busy summer. we had, in addition to most of the attorneys in the office helping with various parts of the research, we had virtually all of our law students, all 10 or 12 of our law students last summer working on it. It's a relatively tight time frame from when cert was granted until our principal brief was due. It's about 8 weeks, 7 or 8 weeks. And as with a case that has been, with any case that has been around for 30 years, there's a big record. There was the record from the 1987 trial itself, in which each individual juror was came into court and was questioned. It was critical to review that whole record so that we could compare the jurors against each other. The prosecutors made a lot of assertions about why they struck the black jurors, as Steve was saying. They gave all these reasons. One of the things that you can really learn when you go through the voir dire, where all the jurors are brought in question, is whether they're actually treating similarly situated jurors the same way. And what we briefed before in the state courts, but really took as close a look at it as we could, was all of, look at every single juror. And what we were able to show, I think, was that the prosecutor said they struck struck Eddie Hood, a black prospective juror, because they had concerns that he had a family member who worked at a nearby mental health hospital. But they accepted a white juror who had worked at that hospital herself. They claimed that they had concerns that Marilyn Garrett was a teacher's aide. They accepted a white juror who was a teacher's aide right in the same area. And so going through all that was a time-consuming process. And then after the direct appeal from that case, then we had the whole habeas record with all the prosecutor's notes from that were introduced at the hearing in 2006. So this was an enormous record, and we spent a lot of time going through it and working up the briefs. Briefs were filed at the end of July, and then we filed a reply brief after the state responded. We filed a reply brief in October. Steve was preparing this whole time for the oral argument and did Steve's practices to do many moot courts before argument. So Steve spent an unbelievable amount of time preparing for the argument, and we were fortunate enough to get to help in that process. And then we went to the argument, and Steve did an outstanding job.
Since most of us will never have this experience, what is it, you've had three times now, what is it like being up in front of the Supreme Court and actually being in the moment arguing the case? And to that end, what have you learned from the first two times that influenced how you have went about the foster case?
Well, let me add one thing about what Patrick just said. We also had an amicus brief filed by former prosecutors who talked about how outraged, including Larry Thompson, former United States attorney here and former number two person at the United States Department of Justice in the Bush administration. So we had a very powerful amicus brief, the only one that was filed for either side, filed by these prosecutors supporting our position in the case. Answer your question, I would say, you know, if you do what we do, if you represent poor and powerless people who have absolutely nothing, the only way you have any chance of evening the scales is to have complete command of the facts. You have to know the facts better than anybody else, because you don't have any power, you don't have any prestige, you don't have anything that's going to get you all of the sort of things that get people by. And I think for Supreme Court arguments, that's even more true. I think particularly when you have these cases, this is the second Batson case I've argued at the court, when we're talking about jury selection, none of the justices know anything about jury selection. They've probably never been in a courtroom when a jury was selected. They're all, you know, former appellate judges or academics, something, but It never, since Thurgood Marshall, it never, and Sotomayor. Sotomayor made an interesting comment. This is not a response to your question. It's interesting. One of the reasons they gave for striking Ms. Garrett was that she had a cousin who had been arrested for drug offenses. Turned out the arrest had not been until well after the trial, so it couldn't have possibly been a reason for striking her, which is problem number one. Justice Sotomayor said, well, did they ask any questions about it? I mean, I have relatives who are in jail. I don't know who they all are or where they are or whatever. And I thought that was, some of you don't hear from the Supreme Court justices very often talking about their relatives in jail. Shows that maybe having a Latina woman on the Supreme Court is not bad in terms of the kind of diversity that Katie was talking about. But basically, in this case, I think, as in any case, that knowing the facts backwards and forwards and being able to answer the factual questions about the case, and it was, you know, you've got a lot to deal with when you've got 40 reasons in all. You've got 9 to 12 reasons on each juror, and you've got to show how they compare to the white jurors and all that. You've really got to know the whole jury selection backwards and forwards. The law is not very important. The law is pretty simple. In this case, at least, what was complicated was the facts. And the facts were what, you know, were going to bring us home. Now, this had another interesting little angle, and then Friday before the Monday oral argument, the court cut an order saying, be prepared to argue this procedural issue. This had never been in a case before. It had never been raised by the state. It was just a procedural issue somebody decided to throw in to try to pull the rug out from under us. Normally in the Supreme Court, you know, each side files a brief, and those are filed fairly far in advance of oral argument. This was Friday before the Monday argument. You know, do some research and just come and be ready. The clerk told me, he said, don't worry, they're not going to ask you about it. Thanks very much. I'm ready. And after I got one sentence out, you know, in this case, the prosecutors came with their lists of definite notes that no black person was going to serve on this jury. Chief Justice Robinson interrupted and said, Mr. Bright, could you address the issue we raised last Friday? Very first thing. So we spent a little bit of time on that, and then Justice Alito, always looking for a procedural way to screw anybody, said, well, what about race judicata? Wasn't this really decided on state law grounds? Again, the state had not raised this. It's not been raised by the state at all. And so we spent a little bit of time on that. So we actually used up about the first 7 or 8 minutes of the argument arguing two issues that weren't in the case that the court just gratuitously gave us. As it turned out, you know, we really worried about it, obviously, but the chief handled that in footnote in the final opinion, and it turned out not to. Although Alito did write a concurring opinion saying, I still think res judicata would take care of this case on independent adequate state grounds. So and this is after the Chief Justice had written this enormously powerful opinion about how these prosecutors have discriminated and lied about it and misrepresented things. The court, you think, ye gods, if this is an injustice, what is? But what's important, Justice Alito? Pull some procedural rug out from under him so we don't get and we kill the guy anyway, despite the race discrimination. It's really an interesting approach to the law and fairness and justice and racism. Not a very good one, but it's his.
If I could just add something to what you guys said about the facts. I just thought it might be interesting. I know there's a lot of law students here. For some of Steve's philosophy in approaching the case and kind of how he led the team, when I was talking to Steve about the case after cert grant, of course we're all elated, and Steve just kept saying, you have to mine the facts. And I think one thing that he's really created at the Southern Center, and that every single one of my colleagues there does, is we never take for granted any of the work that we've done before, that any other attorney's done before, and keep looking at the evidence fresh. There was a lot of new research to be done and a lot of studying the record, but a lot of time, I know we all spent a lot of time just staring at those notes over and over and over again. And we noticed a lot of new things that even though we worked really hard on the case, we hadn't ever found. So just for a couple interesting examples, I remember it was about it was after midnight on the 4th of July. I was working on the claim about Eddie Hood. And I just thought, let me just back check some of the stuff the prosecutor said, some of the reasons we had never really talked about. One of the things he said was that he struck him because he was a member of this Church of Christ. Steve told you earlier about how true that was. That was the one with the no black church note involved. He said, we struck three other jurors from the Church of Christ because of their views on the death penalty. So I said, okay, I should check on these. None of them were struck for their views on the death penalty. One was struck because she said she couldn't be fair on guilt because she thought he did it. One was struck because she was pregnant. And the third one was struck for something completely unrelated. Another time, maybe right before we filed, Patrick, while mining the same record, noticed that a phrase that the prosecutors used to justify one of their strikes, it kind of had an odd wording to it. He noticed that that exact phrase appeared in one of the cases that they had cited. So they had just plagiarized this reason out of a case. They thought, hey, it worked for them. And they literally said it verbatim. So there was always more to find in the case. And I think what makes our work so exciting is we just never assume, you know, just the way Patrick did not assume there was one way to do a cert petition. He put the images in, kind of question what you're doing every step of the way, question the meaning of every single document and every single fact. And this was an incredible case for it because the facts were just bottomless in terms of evidence of injustice.
Wondering, Supreme Court obviously had the deciding 7-1 in Foster, favor of Foster. What does that mean for Timothy Tyrone Foster at this point in time moving forward? And what does it also mean in terms of precedent sets regarding the larger issue of jury selection and racial discrimination?
Well, I would say for Foster means hopefully that his conviction and death sentence are set aside. Of course, all that means you go back and do it again. But in terms of race discrimination and jury selection, I think a couple of things may be useful in the case. One, there are a lot of courts like the 11th Circuit over here that had held that if you gave several reasons, as long as one was race neutral, that was good enough. And this is how bad it was. There's a case where the prosecution strikes this African-American woman, and when the prosecutor gives his reasons, he said, well, she was an African-American woman, and the defendant is an African-American man, and that's why I struck her. Now, some of you are probably thinking, that is not a race-neutral. Are we all together on that? He did not get the memo, apparently. But he did have one other. He said, well, you know, the other thing is, when she answered the questions about the death penalty, it's just the way she answered them. I didn't feel comfortable with that. That's the second reason I struggled. So the case goes, this is a state case, goes far to the Supreme Court. Far to the Supreme Court said one race neutral reason, so the fact that the first reason is blatantly not race neutral doesn't make any difference. Upheld the conviction, comes up here to the 11th Circuit, and the 11th Circuit does the same thing. Says the fact that the second reason was okay, it's blatant. It couldn't be. In Snyder versus Louisiana, the other case that we had, I mean, Justice Alito said, right in the opinion for the court, in that case, that if the reason was substantially motivated by race, then it violates Madison. I think it'd be hard to make that argument that if any reason is okay. Because in this case, certainly some of the reasons were okay. I mean, they gave 9 to 12 reasons for each juror. So, of course, some of them were okay, but a lot of them weren't okay, and a lot of them were lies, and a lot of them were not race neutral, and a lot of them, when you compared it to the white people. So I think that may help a little bit if courts are willing to scrutinize the reasons more. But nothing is going to change the psychology of how prosecutors and judges interact, and the fact that going to be the trial judge is really the person who's most responsible here. They're not going to do anything on this. I just don't think it's, but we've got states that have never had North Carolina, that's a violation, or at least it's the Supreme Court. You know, at the same time this happened, there was a prosecutor, Chatman, in Philadelphia, who was training some young district attorneys there. He was the head of the homicide squad there. And he basically told them, it's a year after Batson, the same year Tim Foster was tried. He told them to strike on the basis of race. This is what the Supreme Court had said the year before. Don't strike on the basis of race. Here's a prosecutor in Philadelphia. You think prosecutors maybe would think they should do justice. I don't know if this is an idea that occurred to me. That they're saying, strike on the basis of race. And he said, and whenever you get a chance, you want to ask those black jurors a lot of questions, and you want to write down on your piece of paper there reasons so you can give reasons for striking. Now, like in our case, serendipitously, this came to light many, many years later when Mr. McMahon had the audacity to run for district attorney. And the incumbent district attorney, Lynn Abraham, suddenly had an ethical, I guess, road to Damascus, an ethical experience, and she decided that ethically she needed to release this training tape, even though it was about 10 years old, she needed to release it to the public. Didn't hurt her re-election campaign. But now we had this tape in which we saw exactly what these people had been told and went back and revisited some Batson cases in which McMahon and his underlings had struck all the blacks. And now, of course, when you look at it with a tape, you look at it in a different light, just like you do in Foster. Most of the time, this evidence is never going to come to light. The discrimination is going to go on. The reasons are going to be given. As I said, you can go now to a training program, and you can get, you know, the Illinois Court of Appeals said, surely every prosecutor is given a list of 20 handy-dandy race-neutral reasons. They were being sarcastic. They are given a list of race-neutral reasons that you can use on anybody in any situation. Unfortunately, our case doesn't prevent that from happening. Sorry, sir.
At this point in time, broadly speaking with the criminal justice system, you're seeing this moment in the past 2 or 3 years where social media and video that's being captured on cell phones is changing the way police interactions are seen in the greater national and international conscience. As you take on newer cases that aren't from 1997, that aren't so far down the line that those kinds of videos don't exist, have you gotten to the point with the Huntley cases, broadly speaking, where you're seeing the impact of social media, whether it's people being more aware of that they are a juror being discriminated against and evidence is coming to light sooner, or that there's just more of an abundance of evidence in the initial trial that's taking place?
That's a very good question. I think people, because of the cell, I say there are two things that have affected the criminal justice system dramatically: DNA evidence and the cell phone. Those two things have told us so much. The DNA evidence tells us we have convicted innocent people, many of them. And not only tells you you've convicted innocent people, it even tells you who the actual person is, the actual perpetrator, who's usually been out. The cell phone tells you that when Walter Scott was running away from the police officer, he took his gun and shot him in the back. It tells you what happened in Louisiana. It tells you what happens in these other situations. And people now have an awareness of things that, I mean, you look at the Laquan McDonald tape in Chicago. There were, I believe this is right, 31 police reports written that all said he lunged at the police with a knife. The videotape, which was kept suppressed for 13 months, showed that he never lunged. He was actually going out and away, and that Officer Van Dyke shot him over and over again, and even when he was on the ground, they continued to fire shots into him. That cost that district attorney re-election, so it clearly, as did the Tamir Rice video, cost the Cleveland district attorney re-election. So I think we have a much greater awareness of the interaction with law enforcement and people of color, I think what people are need to start looking at is the fact that this doesn't end with what happens with the shooting or the arrest or whatever, but of the people that arrest, what happens when they go into the criminal justice system. Because all these discretionary decisions are going to be made. Are we going to grant bail or not? Are we going to charge or not? A lot of cases are not charged at all. A lot of cases are. Are we going to charge the most serious count we can, or are we going to charge a misdemeanor count? What's the plea offer going to be? All of those kinds of things, all these discretionary decisions, all made by white people in a system that often is almost exclusively black people being affected by it. And so there's got to be a great deal more. I don't think there is at this point. Although we did have a cell phone, someone took their cell phone into the municipal court in Bowdoin, Georgia. I'm sure you all remember where that is. Monday night, they're having court, and the municipal court judge is fining people. These municipal courts are all just cash cows for their community. They're not courts by any stretch of the imagination. They've got these little dinky police departments that go out and write tickets and bring people in on Monday night and try to shake them down. And so this person recorded the whole session, and the judge is saying to people a $500 fine or whatever, how much can you come up with tonight? Call your family, go to the ATM, use your credit card, do whatever you want. But if you don't come up with some money tonight, you're going to jail. Now, this is unconstitutional in a whole bunch of ways. Beard versus Georgia, which says you can't lock people up unless it's a willful failure to pay. Right to counsel, which you can't lock people up unless they're represented by counsel. It goes on. The cell phone captured the whole court proceeding. I don't think it's going to happen a whole lot. But we do have more cameras in the court. We do have more looking at it. And I think people have to start looking at this really serious problem of the courts, because the people running the courts don't look anything like the people being processed through the courts. And that's affecting the way those people are treated. And that's the way the way that people see the way they're being treated. In the Snyder case, we put in our brief, black people in Jefferson Parish, Louisiana, know that they are not a part of the criminal justice system. They're always struck from the jury. They never serve on a jury. They know they are not, they're disenfranchised, basically. And white people know it too. And courts like that, as Kate said, they don't have any credibility, they don't have any legitimacy, they're not entitled to any credibility or any legitimacy. But we have to worry not only about juries, but we have to worry about judges and prosecutors that are making discretionary decisions in these cases, and why these courts are coming down so much harder on people of color than they are on white people.
The Southern Center has turned 40 this year, and when we were chatting with the story about you, one of the things that really stuck out to me, and I asked you, having done this kind of work for as long as you have, what is the thing that still surprises you? And you replied that the indifference to which judges who know that the system is not operating properly go along with it. I'm wondering for the three of you, what do you think, what still surprises you doing this work that you're working out? Going to courts, investigating, and what is that thing for you? Having been working on as long, but still experiencing death penalty cases or other kinds of cases on a day in and day out basis.
I think the thing that always jumps out at me whenever we go to court with our clients is how our clients are so often not treated with any dignity at all. They're just marched in. I mean, their lives and liberty are at stake. And the system that's supposed to have integrity and supposed to be the face of the community in terms of justice shows the clients no dignity, completely disrespectful toward the clients, as if the lawyers and the judges are up here in this class, and then the clients are marched in, and they're in a very, very different class. And that surprises me every time we go to court.
Yeah, one of the things I would say about Rome, Georgia specifically is that, you know, you read these briefs and you know that the racism occurred there, but you go into Rome, and for everyone who doesn't know, Rome is about an hour and 15 minutes outside of Atlanta. It's northwest. And you drive into Rome, and right away, if you're from Atlanta, and if you're a person of color, from my experience, they know right away that you're not there. And I'm dressed just like anyone else. So I went into a restaurant and I ordered some food, and the person there said, what are you doing here? Are you here for lunch? Are you meeting with someone? And I've been to many towns and cities in Alabama, and I've never been asked anywhere if I'm here to meet with someone or like why I'm in a restaurant. So I said, oh, I'm just eating, and I'm looking at the menu. And so I started talking to them about the menu, and they were like, well, are you from here? And I'm like, oh, not too far away. And I'm like beginning to order because I'm a little nervous about, are they gonna ask me, am I here for the Tim Foster case? You know, I'm just really wondering what's happening. But what's most amazing about those experiences is that although you know the racism occurs, it's always surprising to me how very real it is. And when going to talk with Eddie Hood and Marilyn Garrett, you see in their faces. I remember when I went to Eddie Hood, before he even knew that he was going to be mentioned in this court case, I told him what was going on, and he was like, wow. He was like, okay, this is from the 1980s. I can't believe it. They told me that they struck me because my son was arrested for something. And I was like, well, no, really, that's like totally fine that your son was arrested. They shouldn't have struck you for that reason. And he stood back and he said, wow. He was like, I am surprised it's 30 years later and this is what's happening. So what's amazing is just how grateful a lot of people are that the Southern Center works on racial discrimination, and how appreciative people are in small towns like Rome. You know, it's all over their newspapers. They're like, I think that seeing racial discrimination in your newspapers in Rome, Georgia is not something that people are waking up expecting to see, because they're totally fine with racial discrimination. There are tons of people who are totally fine with racial discrimination in Georgia, particularly in the criminal justice system. One of the things that I think Steve touched on was so great. I mean, obviously we have cameras and obviously you see police brutality, but I think oftentimes people who face racial discrimination in the courtroom never think that everyone's going to find out about it. So that's one of the most amazing things, just working on this case, that the jurors are pretty grateful this happened. And of course, Tim Foster is grateful, but they also have a personal, their own victory with this.
Yeah, I would say my answer is a lot like Steve's. I was attracted to this work. I was actually Steve's student in law school. And I very quickly thought, I'm going to follow that man and do what he tells me to do as long as he doesn't allow me to do that. And that was the best decision I ever made in my life. But I thought the idea that no one is irredeemable, that there is something good and beautiful in every human being, was such a powerful idea. And I wanted to meet the people that society has said are the worst people. Now that part, I was right about that. All of my clients, I've never had a client where I haven't found something that is really surprising and lovely and charming or compassionate about them. I mean, I've often thought, are people on death row just nicer? I'm confused, but they're really, if you go in with a generous heart, you will find something beautiful in these people. At the same time, I think I used to take a more empathic approach to the other side of the system, to the prosecutors. I would think, okay, why do they feel like this is the appropriate answer? Maybe they don't want the federal government interfering in states' rights. Okay, I could see that, that's a philosophy. Maybe they are really, really disturbed by crime. They are very scared about safety in their community. All right, they take that duty seriously, that's great. What I found is that that is not true. I have been astonished at not only what people will do, but what they will not do. when they're faced with things that are immoral, unethical, and illegal. Those aren't always the same thing, but oftentimes they are, and people still don't act. And the way that this tends to happen in the criminal justice system is everyone passes the buck to someone else. The courts will say, no, this isn't for me to decide, it's not my fault, it was Congress. You know, and prison officials will do very similar things, say, oh, that's outside my authority, I'm not the one who can do that, without ever really taking responsibility for the fact there's a huge injustice staring them in the face. And I've come to realize, and I've told, you know, some people in my life, you know, this job has made me realize that some people really are immoral, and it has not been my clients who have taught me that lesson. They have confirmed the opposite. But, you know, I think it's, I doubt that many of the people who are doing those things would admit to themselves that that's what they're doing. I think it's all very banal, and it's about processing people, and they don't see themselves as being an active villain, but they are. And I think, you know, taking a step back, not getting mired in the day-to-day of your job, and being willing to recognize when something's happening that's just completely wrong, and then being professional and motivated enough to not just hang up your hat at 5 o'clock, but sit and work and figure it out for the sake of some person's life. That's just not something I see in the criminal justice system. And I've been just shocked by that.
Let me just give this little example, which has nothing to do with the death penalty and a lot to do with how we treat children. The Cordial Judicial Circuit hired a woman as a prosecutor of juveniles, children, in juvenile court. She wasn't any good, and so they let her go. And her last day as the prosecutor of juveniles was May 31. The next day, June 1st, was her first day as the public defender for juveniles. The public defender office hired her without any search, without any trying to find somebody qualified. And now she is representing, at least in theory, the people that she was just recently prosecuted. I've been doing this 40 years, and things like that just continue to surprise me. In this circuit, they don't care anything about the kids. Most of the kids don't get represented at all, and when they are represented, they're represented in the most perfunctory way imaginable. But that's so beyond the pale that you would hire that you would A, use the public defender office as a place for unemployed lawyers, and B, that you would have the juvenile prosecutor now being the juvenile public defender and theoretically defending the same kids that she prosecuted. I mean, every day I go around the office and talk to people, and Sarah Garrity tells me about debtors' prisons, and I see about private probation companies that are exploiting people. It's really, really remarkable the things that we continue to see in the system. And as Katie points out, I mean, very often the people who are in charge of the system, the judges, the prosecutors, the people that are supposed to ensure the integrity of the system, are very much a part of the corruption that goes on day in and day out in the criminal justice system. I'll just say this real quick on that. I mean, going to any court when they're having meet them and plead them. People come into court, they meet a defense lawyer, this ends the court deal, ends all of this day. You meet a defense lawyer for 5 or 10 minutes. Often the people are all in handcuffs. They're brought in, it looks like a slave ship is stocked outside the courthouse, and all these black men in orange jumpsuits, as Patrick says, no sense of dignity whatsoever. It looks like slaves being brought into the court, and they're deposited in the first couple of rows of jury box, and some hack lawyer comes through and talks to each one. Of course, these are not confidential communications because there's a person on either side of them. They're handcuffed together. You can't. And then the judge takes the bench, and they all plead guilty, and they're sentenced. And that's all the lawyering they get, and that's all the judging they get. And everybody in that courtroom, just like I said with the Batson strikes, everybody knows how totally corrupt that system is. The judge knows it, the prosecutors know it, the defense lawyers know it, the people in the audience, they know good well, the family members sitting there, these people aren't represented. They were never, the judge always says, and are you satisfied with your lawyer? How would they know? How would you know if all you did was meet a person for 15 minutes and pled guilty because they told you that was the only thing you could do? How would you know whether you were satisfied or not? I mean, you don't know what a lawyer does. You haven't been interviewed. There hasn't been any investigation. There hasn't been any looking into legal issues. There haven't been any pleadings filed. There hasn't been any effort to find out anything about you, so there'll be an individualized sentencing at the end of this process. We're just processing these people through like hamburgers at a fast food restaurant. And everybody is in on that, and it goes on all the time in the system. And you can point it out, as we have done over and over and over again, Judge Pritchard Cordell doesn't have a nice thing to say about us. But really what he should do is change that system, not be mad at the people who point out the corruption of that system and the fact that people are supposed to get individualized treatment as they go through the court system, and they don't get it most of the time, poor people don't, in the criminal courts in the state of Georgia.
I can add a really mundane example that just really shocked me recently. So that was kind of on the higher level, the big decision maker. So this is more of a low level issue. We've been working on some cases with people who got life without parole sentences for selling a really, really small amount of drugs. And one of the cases that I was working on involved a man who'd been in prison for over 20 years, and he had kidney failure and was on dialysis, and he needed to get that 3 times a week. Or he would die. I mean, that is how dialysis works. If you skip it and you have an emergency and then you go to the emergency room, you're dying. That's not an okay emergency to let happen. I, for weeks, emphasized this to the prison, and all I needed from them was some records to set him up with a dialysis center when he got help. Everybody passed me to someone else. His counselor, the people in the warden's office, the people in the records office. Finally, I got someone who was actually the medical staff, and she said, well, when he's released, he's no longer our responsibility, and I have 30 days to get you any records. It was clear to me that she was more concerned about going home at 5 than this man's life, and I couldn't believe that. And then the day before the hearing, I thought, they're gonna forget his insulin. He's insulin dependent. So I went to the prison, and I spoke to the warden himself. And I said, this man, when he goes to this hearing out of town, 2 hours away, he needs his medication with him. And he said, you got it, no problem. Of course, the next day he shows up without medication. He's freed after 20 years. And the first place he goes as a free man is the emergency room. Nobody there was, beating him or shooting him, some of the more blatant abuses we see, but all of those people were failing to dignify his life with even so much as their time.
Adam, how are we doing on the time?
I'm afraid we're actually about to lose the room, so I don't know if any of the panelists have any final thoughts or wanted to respond to a question they just couldn't get to. I would love to have audience questions, and we almost always do at ACS events, but between the time and the extraordinary nature of our panel, I hope none of us are leaving unfulfilled. Do any of the panelists have any final thoughts they can leave us with as we exit today? Great. Well, I hope you're
running out of time.
Yeah, we are out of time. If we could join me, please, and thank you all for coming. I have nothing that I can add that's anything better than what these wonderful people and lawyers and warriors have said here tonight. I will say that just listening, I'm reminded of the aphorism of Mr. Rogers, who as a kid would watch something terrible or traumatic on TV and would ask his mother what he should do, and she would say, look to the helpers. look to the people who run towards the sirens, look to the people who charge into the breach. And sitting behind me right now are people who charge into the breach in these trying times. So if you appreciate that as much as I do, A, I hope we plan for more ACS events as we continue our calendar throughout the year, and B, please join me one more time in thanking Art for attending. Validations from Mr. Joyce outside and
No, I know we ran out.